next week. In the meantime, we're going to go over, for our class, we're going to go over briefly the principles of discovery. Now, the principles of discovery are principles we came up with in the group years ago about how it was around the idea of what can kind of the average seeker who's maybe doesn't have like direct contact with a master or spirit world or all these things, you know, that a lot of people claim, he's just kind of ordinary seeker trying to figure out what's true and what's not. What are principles he can use to figure out what is true and to separate the true from the false? And we came up with quite a few principles. We'll go over a number of them this morning here. The first principle is to find anchors. And that is, finding anchors involves this. You take the things you know with reasonable surety to be true. And then you use them as the foundation or stepping stones for testing additional truths. In other words, you know pretty sure there's a thing called gravity out there, right? So therefore, if you walk to the edge of a cliff, you don't want to walk over it, because you're likely to fall and hurt yourself. So you use this as a foundation stone for other truths. So you avoid falling off the edge of a cliff because you know gravity really works in this reality. Now, there's a lot of people that say, well, everything in this world is illusion. You can't really find anything in this world that's absolutely true, you know, because it's all illusion. You hear that more and more lately. And it's kind of this attitude kind of takes people into more illusion. Because, yeah, this reality we're in is built upon illusionary principles. But still, the illusionary principles so far in this universe has lasted for 13 and a half billion years, which is quite a length of time. And so we're here in this reality for a while, so we have to look at the rules. And as far as basic principles go, they even transcend this reality into the higher worlds. So, and they're also a bridge. When you recognize what is truly happening or seems to be happening in this world, and you perceive it accurately, that true perception will take you, guide you to the world of intuition, to where you can see the higher things also. So there's a lot of people out there that kind of discount the idea of finding any truth at all in this world. And consequently, they're in kind of a little world of their own sometimes, where they are even more divorced from reality than they think a person in the world is divorced from reality. So what we want to do in this world, because many seekers are unsure what is true and what isn't, but there are certain things that you know pretty sure are true. Okay, let's go through, we'll go through 10 examples of things that you can grasp that, you know, you're pretty sure is the truth. One is basic math. Now, if someone tells you that 2 + 2 does not equal 4, then, you know, you've got a problem to deal with. 2 + 2 = 4 in this reality. Now, there's people who will come and use something like the binary system or something like this and say, in other ways of figuring it, 2 + 2 = 4. But
taxi cab geometry.
Yeah, that's a bunch of sophistry. But in our reality, math is basically works. That's a truth that we can depend on. So you can take math, and you know that math is basically representative of truth in this reality. So if someone tells you something that isn't mathematically accurate, then you can suspect that they're on a path that is not leading you toward the truth. And so that's basic math is one of the strongest anchors that we can have, because if people go off of basic math, then they're usually headed toward greater illusion. Okay, any comment on that? Okay, another anchor is this. Truth does not contradict truth. Okay, if two statements contradict, then one or both of them are wrong or not understood correctly. And in the New Age movement, it's interesting how people often have conflicting beliefs. For instance, they'll read, some people like will accept everything if it claims to be channeled from some high entity. And so they'll read one work where it teaches reincarnation, for instance. And then another work that says there's no reincarnation, yet the person will believe them both. He'll think that both of them are true and both of them are from a reliable source, even though on this idea, one teaches one thing and another the opposite. So if either reincarnation happens or it doesn't, okay? So you can't really have it both ways. So there's certain things, it's like the Course in Miracles says, the truth is true and nothing else is true. So if 2 + 2 = 4, it doesn't equal anything in the universe but 4. If reincarnation happens in this reality, then it happens. If it doesn't happen, then it doesn't happen. Both cannot be true. So this is one thing you want to look for, and it should be obvious, but it's not very obvious. For instance, this is one of the things that led me out of my religion when I was younger, is I found that some of the teachings in the church contradicted other teachings in the church. And some of the teachings from the modern authorities contradicted the older authorities that have passed on. So I think, they both can't be true. And why am I supposed to accept the modern authorities over the dead authorities just because they're here now? And so the truth does not contradict truth. And applying this principle can be a strong key in leading you to the discovery of truth. So find those things that you know with pretty strong certainty are true. And if things contradict it, then you can pretty much discount it. But you always have to be open to the possibility that even though these things that you thought were true, young, with pretty strong certainty, always have to be open to the fact that new revelation to yourself, new knowledge will alter your perspective on that. So we always have to be open to that. Okay, any comment on that before we move on?
Well, there is just but one principle and one truth, and it's infinitely diverse. It comes to us, it percolates through the illusion through many windows, and through those windows sometimes are very distorted, and some are more clear than others. And it's our responsibility to assimilate those truths in the best way we can too.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you hear people say, you have your truth and I have my truth, and they're okay with that. You know, it's like whatever they think is their truth, but they don't go any deeper than just a superficial interpretation of what that truth might be.
What they're using, though, is the wrong words. What they're really saying is, you have your belief and I have mine.
Right.
Belief isn't necessarily truth. But you, a lot of people, especially in the New Age movement, use that term. Well, you have your truth and I have mine, like both of us have truth. Even though it contradicts.
Sometimes you find a major chunk of truth and you think you found it all, but in reality, you've just found one piece of a bigger truth.
Yeah.
More universal truth.
Yeah, and that's what happens with a lot of these religious people. They think they found the whole truth and they just got a really small piece of it. And breaking out from a religious thought form is really an important step for a seeker to take, because then he finds there's a whole world of light out there that he hasn't been exposed to yet.
Yeah, like the elephant principle. Blind man grabs the ear and thinks the elephant is like a leaf, doesn't see the whole picture.
Yeah, yeah. And we always ought to be open to that. Okay, the third anchor is experience. Experience is to be trusted unless one comes across a good reason to doubt it. Okay, it's true, even experience can lead a person astray, even a true spiritual experience. I've met people that have had true spiritual experience, and then they get kind of, their attention goes off of the light somewhat, and then they do not recall the experience accurately. And maybe even later on, they discount the experience. So even a true experience can be altered to the extent that, or distorted, so the true reality isn't seen. But normally, we can trust our experiences. We don't trust anything 100%, but this is an anchor. If you've had an experience, for instance, if you've had an experience where you sense there's a presence within you that's connected to God, okay? If you have that experience and you think, you know, there is something there, you know, beyond the physical reality, there's a connection, I've experienced it, and you trust it. If it's winter time and it's cold outside, you have experienced cold, well, you know that you need to go wear a coat when you go outside, okay, because of your experience. Overall, experience is something that you can use as an anchor. So if you've experienced something, and then somebody is teaching you something that goes contrary to what you've actually experienced, then go by your experience. They did this experiment about how group thinking distorts even experience. For instance, I can't remember exactly how the experiment went, but there was like they had like four objects in the middle of a table or something, and everybody, like there was 20 people in the group, and everybody knew what the experiment was except for one guy. Okay, so everybody in the group, they asked, well, how many objects are there? And there's really four. You can see there's four, but everybody says there's three. And so everybody, when they repeat how many is there, they get back to the person, or maybe there's one or two in the group that is the focus of the experiment. They don't know what's going on. About 9 out of 10 of them eventually agreed that there was three instead of four, even though they could see four, whatever. And so, so I found this quite amazing, and it explains why people in groups will even go against their experience, against their perception, because of the power of group thought over them. And so your experience, what you can see, goes beyond, should override the power of what the group or what outside authorities tell you you're supposed to think. And this explains why, this experiment explains why, like in politics, for instance, that people will believe what they're told to believe, even if it goes against what their own experience. What was interesting was they did experiments with, you know how people have hated Trump or hated Obama. They take stuff that Obama and Trump and different politicians have said, and for instance, they'll take something Trump has said and tell an Obama supporter that Obama said it, and they'll say, oh, that's really great, terrific, okay. But then you tell them that Trump said it, they say, oh, guess I didn't like that after all. So it's interesting how that happens. They've done they've done this quite a bit in interviews, and when they tell them that their favorite politician has said something that the guy that they hate says, they think it's wonderful. And so that's like a little bit like the experiment, four objects in the middle of the table. Everybody says there's three, so you go along with the three. And so it's interesting how easy it is for people to be led away from the truth. Okay, any comment on that before we go to the next one?
Yeah, can I just say, go ahead, Josh. I'm sorry. Go ahead, please.
No. But if you get enough thinking a certain way, ardently thinking, that creates a thought form, and new people buy into that thought form. Like people of a certain religion believe certain scriptures above other scriptures because that's the way they're taught. That's just because they're buying into this form created by a multitude of thinkers or thoughts.
Yeah, and this is an important thing in the discovery of truth, is to be able to sense thought forms. Because people, when they combine their beliefs, create an actual presence, an actual intelligence in the form of a thought form. And then when you join that group, that thought form has a powerful influence on you. But if you can recognize that thought form, then you can say, this is what the thought form says. And this is what happened to Curtis and I when we worked ourselves out of the Mormon thought form. We eventually reached a point where we could say, this is the Mormon thought form, but we don't have to buy into it. We want the truth, not what is in the thought form. And so, and this happens, there's thought forms out there. Now there's powerful political thought forms on the left and on the right. And when you hear a politician talking, true seeker needs to say, no, here's what I'm getting from the thought form, but I don't have to buy into it. I want the truth, not what's in the thought form. Now, what's in the thought form may be true. There's pieces of truth in every thought form, but you don't have to get your truth from the thought form. You get it from your own soul. And when you get it from your own soul, then you'll be on the right path. Okay, Christine, you had something?
I was just gonna say, I have a friend who does Facebook marketing ads. She's for multi-million dollar companies. And so she is very in tune with the research and things. And if you show people a video or a product, and what they do is they look at the number of likes. And if a lot of people like it, they're going to like it. And if you flip-flop it where it got the same video or the same product, got a bunch of thumbs down or a bunch of negative comments, people in a herd mentality or a specific energetic thought form, they follow what feels safe and what is the herd, because they are not using their internal validation. All they know is external validation. So their thought changes like that, and they follow what other people do. Very easy with a certain, you know, mindset of people who rely on external validation for their truth. It was super interesting. Yeah, it's the same thing like you were saying in politics, but this is like for marketing. They use it, right?
Yeah, fascinating. It's used everywhere in religion.
Yeah, politics, yeah, for sure.
Business.
Yes.
And
the herd mentality.
It's
right.
It's
conformity. So
and yeah. Matter of fact, this is one of my most important teachings, is the mark of this is actually the mark of the beast.
Mark. I read that in your stuff yesterday.
Oh, you did? Oh, good.
I did. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. I did. It's fascinating.
Because the mark of the beast is being led by an outside authority that takes the place of your inside authority. And you escape the mark of the beast by going on your inside authority and being able to tune out the thought forms on the outside. And it's easier said than done. A lot of people think they've done it and they haven't really done it. You know, a lot of people just move from one thought form to another.
Just
being transparent. I escaped this controlling religion, and then they go under some control of a guru that's even more controlling still.
I taught it. I taught newly married classes with an abusive man, like I did, and I taught submission. Okay, I'm just saying, like I was in the thought form, I drank the Kool-Aid, okay, for a long time, but not anymore.
Yeah, but the great part is when you've been through that and then escape, then it you really understand what's going on. Now, there's other people I've talked to that say, boy, I've never had any problem. I wasn't raised in a strong religion and so on. And these people maybe don't really understand the escape from the thought form, but then they will eventually have some powerful thought form tempt them away from the inner self, which they'll have to struggle with. But there's always a struggle somewhere between the inner and the outer. And it's not always religion. It could be politics. It could be business. Could be even science, because let's take science for instance. They discovered all kinds of bones in over 100 years ago of giants, people that were 11 foot tall or so, and there's records of these discoveries, and they were given to the Smithsonian, and they have disappeared. Nobody knows where they are. People think somewhere in this Smithsonian is a bunch of bones of giants hidden in some basement somewhere, you know. But anyway, when discoveries are made that goes against what the scientific community accepts as orthodoxy, the evidence tends to like disappear. So people today, especially, we hear, well, I follow the science, like the science is infallible. Well, the science isn't infallible, because the science is often distorted. We often have just bits and pieces of the science with a lot of bits and pieces missing. And so the science is not infallible. That's another thought form that's out there that they're saying, I follow the science. Okay, well, everybody that I hear saying they follow the science really doesn't know anything about science.
Well, don't they choose, wouldn't you say, they also choose what science they seek, and therefore what they know, and therefore what they believe. Like, no one can like know all the science. So they don't realize that they have a particular perspective.
Yeah.
That they are perhaps seeking to validate consciously or unconsciously. I mean, I don't know, but they don't know all science, right? Like, right.
Well, I had an uncle that was a nuclear physicist and very steeped in the world of science and was quite knowledgeable and intelligent, book smart. But if you were to approach him on a spiritual truth like reincarnation or eternal progression, even from kingdom to kingdom, which is also a corruption.
He was a strong Mormon.
Yeah, I mean, he would just shatter like glass. You know, he would become uprooted and argumentative, and well, you just have to follow the prophet, because, you know, when he speaks, the truth is, you know, he's thought it out, and you don't have to think for yourself. But here he was, this highly educated scientific man who just crumbled when a spiritual truth was presented that was contrary to what he thought.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's interesting how people can be very logical on maybe 80% of their life, and then you approach a certain part where they buy into a certain thought form. That thought form comes first, and that thought form will make them deny reality just about. It's in that certain area. Now, everybody has a blind spot, which is interesting. We did a thing in our class where we found a internet place that shows you how to see your blind spot. And you look at these two objects or something, and then in a certain way, one of them will like disappear because you actually have a blind spot in your vision, a kind of a black hole.
Vision.
Yeah. So there's a certain, now because we have two eyes, and they kind of fill in the blind spot for us, our consciousness does. We don't normally see it, but it is there. And this is symbolic of a spiritual blind spot that all of us have. And so each one of us needs to find our own blind spot so that we can see the truth that is hidden with our own blind spot. Because there's always something, and this is where often connected to what we are supposed to learn in a particular life. And we learn it by seeing beyond that point within our consciousness to where it's very difficult for us to see what is true and what is really there. So everybody has a physical blind spot and a spiritual blind spot. I'll have to find a link on the internet for the blind spot, and so if you haven't done it yet, you can check it out and see that you actually do have one, because there's when you look around the room, it doesn't look like there's any blind spot, but there is actually one in your vision, but you can't see it unless you have some outer kind of focus to bring that into your consciousness. So it's,
well, if we're really open, we can see each other's blind spots and point them out. And if you can go beyond the ego of some kind of self-preservation, have to preserve my own blind spot. But, you know, if we can see each other's blind spots and reveal them, then that's one of the advantages of being in a molecule too.
Right, and that's a really good point, Curtis. It's about 100 times easier to see someone else's blind spot than your own, because you can't really see your blind spot. But that's why it's important to pay attention to what other people say about you, because other people will say if they complain about a certain part of your thinking. if you hear that over and over and over, then you might ask yourself, do I have a blind spot in connection with this? Because it's so much easier for other people to see it than for you to see it yourself. So listen to what other people say about you. Even the criticism, I know it's really hard to take criticism. We don't want to hear it, but outward criticism is important because it can lead us to where a blind spot is. And when you know you have a blind spot in a certain area, you can compensate and see the truth that you have been missing. And this is often connected to the truth that you're supposed to learn in a particular lifetime. Okay, any more comment on that before we move on here? Okay, the anchor number four is this. For every cause, there is an effect. That's a true principle that's true in all the different realities that you can imagine. It's true from the one life that created everything, which is cause, and that one life produced effects, which is the whole universe. And within that universe is you and me, and we go about and create cause. You turn the key to start your car, you cause your car engine to come on, so you were a cause that produced an effect. You type the letter A on your keyboard, the letter A appears on your screen. So you were a cause, you produced an effect. And so for every cause, there is an effect. Now people say we can move beyond cause and effect, which if you look on this reality is pure illusion that is possible, but we are in the illusion. And in this illusion, in this reality, in the physical material world, cause and effect play out. And so if a person has an attitude that this world is illusionary, he does not want to step over a cliff because he will fall and kill himself. Okay, so we are in this reality, so we have to deal with causes and effects in this reality so we can live a productive, comfortable, happy life. If we ignore cause and effect, then your life will just not work. So oftentimes, you look at cause and effect, you can see things that are not true. For instance, a really obvious one is the Eucharist in the Catholic Church. They believe when they eat that wafer that it actually turns into the actual physical body of Christ is entering into your body. Then when they drink the wine or whatever they drink there, they think it is actually turns into the blood of Christ in your body, okay? So when you look at cause and effect, there is no cause that would make that happen. And so the effect that you think is has no cause behind it. So you can look at things like this and say, well, what would cause that to happen? Well, maybe God up in heaven points his finger and makes it happen or something like that, but that's pretty unrealistic. So you look at cause and effect, you can unravel a lot of teachings that are out there and see that, well, this cause and effect principle doesn't really apply. A while back, several members were concerned about Planet X showing up. And there were since we've had the Keys group, there's been about half a dozen different prophecies of Sitchin's teachings about Planet X supposed to circle around every 3,600 years, and every 3,600 years show up and produce tremendous destruction here upon planet Earth. And so Sitchin's followers are all looking for Planet X to show up. And so about once every 6 months, somebody makes a prediction about Planet X showing up. So I remember the first time I've encountered that, they say, well, Planet X is a red dwarf and it will be here in 6 months, and it'll be here March 15th, such and such. The guy made specific predictions. Several in the group were alarmed. They thought, one lady in particular told me, I need to warn everybody about this. I mean, this is really important. And so I looked at the cause and effect and principles. And for one thing, a brown dwarf star, something that would classify as a brown dwarf, if it was going to be here within 6 months, would be visible, would be close enough to be visible in the sky and be brighter than Jupiter or Venus. And so I look up in the sky and I don't see any brown dwarf up there. So because of cause and effect, I knew that we would not have Planet X be here on the predicted day. So I told the group, you know, Planet X will not be here on the predicted day. And the one gal that was really big on this, she was so upset, she quit the group, never saw her again. And even after the time passed where Planet X didn't show up and I was proven to be right, she still never came back. But cause and effect, just analyzing cause and effect can help sort out a lot of things that are not true, especially in the alternative spiritual reality. Now, the alternative spiritual teachings out there are really good, but there's so much illusion out there also that and misinformation that a person really has to apply the true principles of finding the truth to be able to sort all this out. If he just goes by what you know, stimulates his emotional body, he's gonna fall for all kinds of things that are not true. Okay, any more comment on cause and effect?
I took a class, in fact, several classes in Los Angeles taught by a guy named Bayard Hora, who headed up a project called Nexus about living in the here and now. And his intent was to create leaders in politics and social climate. And he says, you're either living at cause, making things happen, or at effect, where things are happening to you. So you have to decide, how do I want to live, at cause or at effect? And if you're living at effect, you become a victim. If you're living at cause, you become a conscious creator in the material world. You make things happen. So you have to ask yourself, how am I living in this moment? Am I making things happen, or are things just happening to me and I'm just kind of rolling with the current, like a lot of people think. I'll just kind of roll with it and move gently down the stream. But you really have to ask yourself, am I making something happen? What am I, and what is that that I'm causing to make happen? And then you become a true initiate, because you begin to initiate things.
Yeah, and that goes along with my teachings about the decision, which is your life is either governed by your decisions that you make, or someone else's are governing your life.
Right.
So what do you want to govern your life? You want to be in control of your destiny and make decisions about how it's going to turn out? Or do you want to just be like a leaf floating in a stream where other people's decisions are deciding where your life is going to go? So we have a decision about decisions facing us as to how the direction of our life. So good comments are in that direction. Okay, number five, data can be easily fabricated, but principles cannot. Therefore, what you want to look for is the true principle, not so much data. Now, you look at a lot of this channel material that's out there, they'll give you all kinds of data. They'll talk about the fourth dimension, fifth dimension, sixth dimension, or 20th reality or 30th reality. They'll talk about a certain star system with a bunch of planets there. And that's all data. Anybody can make up that stuff. For instance, I was reading a while back about all kinds of relation channelings from the Pleiades. And the Pleiades, they say that there's an advanced ancient civilization there that sends spacecraft here every once in a while. Well, let's look at the details here. The stars in the Pleiades, according to science, are only 100 million years old. Now, how anybody know how old the Earth is, according to science?
Older than that.
Yeah, well, it's 4.5 billion years old, and the sun is a little bit older than the Earth. And so we're, compared to the Pleiades, we're over 20 times older than the Pleiades. Now, because the Pleiades is a new, composed of new stars, that means any planets that's circling around them are just gas. And there's no solid bodies even available. There'd be no spacecraft or solid. If there's any entities that exist and planets circling around this Pleiades, they'd be gaseous of some type. Entities. So,
hot air.
So we can approach these people and say that talk about space beings from the Pleiades. Well, how can they make spaceships out of gas? You know, because that's all that's available on the planet circling around there. So you can.
JJ, let me correct you here. The thing you don't understand about the Pleiadians is they're from a previous incarnation of the Pleiadian star system that lived on past that and then remanifested the physical space stations and planets. So all those concerns don't matter. It's all taken care of.
That could be the only scientific explanation or esoteric explanation. That is a possibility, okay?
And there's life everywhere, and then much of that life everywhere exists on different frequencies of matter.
Yeah, it's possible they exist in some etheric matter in the Pleiades. So, you know, there's all kinds of possibilities. But looking at what we know for sure, it becomes highly suspect that they have, that there's an ancient civilization in the Pleiades.
But do we know for sure that there's no solid matter, no solid planets in the Pleiadians?
Well, yeah, it takes over a billion years to create it takes several generations of stars to create something like the Earth. Now the Pleiades are a first generation of stars, and so you're young, and they don't have heavy elements like we have here. Our sun is a second generation sun, and so it and its planets have heavier elements, and they will live much longer. And so anyway, it's interesting what if you check out all the science in connection with the stars and everything, and put it all together, some of these people have to go into additional explanations. But you know, that's an interesting part about approaching spiritual teachings that don't make sense is there's so many different things in reality that you can add into it. Like Ed just says, and Joshua said, well, maybe it was a previous incarnation of the Pleiades. Well, that's a possibility.
Were you aware that I was making a joke, though?
What say?
Were you aware that I was joking, though? I mean, it technically.
No, I was aware you were being lighthearted, but it's still a possibility. I presented this with the star system Sirius, which is also much younger than our star. I can't remember how old it is. It's older than the Pleiades. But the Tibetan does say this about the life. He says there's life on Sirius, very evolved life. But he says they don't have the kingdoms on Sirius that they have here. We have the vegetable, mineral, animal, human. He says they don't exist on Sirius. It's a life of another sort, which would have to be true because Sirius is a younger star system than our Earth. And the chances are there's not Earth-like planets circling around Sirius. There would be more gaseous type planets there also. But so the Tibetan actually said something that was kind of in alignment, saying that life is a lot different there. It's composed of, they don't have the kingdoms there like they have here. But he says that the Blue Lodge is on Sirius. It's very advanced. And it's possible, like Joshua said, and I pointed this out in the treatise, that it's possible that Sirius is a reincarnation of another very ancient star system. So so that's interesting. Okay, let's go on to the next one. So you go on to principles. If you find the principle behind things, then you can test things according to the principle, like the principle of cause and effect, for instance. That's a principle. You find principles, and truth is always in harmony with principles. But you find somebody says he gives all kinds of facts and data out. You don't know if somebody just made it up or what, but you just can't make up a principle. You discover principles and reveal them. But you just don't make them up. Because once a principle is discovered and revealed, it speaks to your soul, and you can sense that the principle is true. But data is much more difficult. Like, say the age of the Great Pyramid, everybody's got a different idea, and even channeled material, one channeled material disagrees with another. Nobody is in harmony with how old the Great Pyramid is. For instance, it's getting true data is very difficult. It takes a very advanced soul on the level of a master to be able to read the Akashic records correctly. The regular psychic, he kind of tunes into the Akashic records and gets bits and pieces here, and they don't put them together accurately, so they don't give us accurate information quite often.
Well, like the Keys of Enoch by Hertak, he used a lot of big words like tetrahexahedrons and, you know, and something that, wow, you read that and go, wow, this guy's really an adept. But when you try to grasp the principle that he's presenting, he's weighed in the balance and found wanting.
Yeah, that guy's got a vocabulary. It's out of this world. He's really done a lot of research in science, but I can't, even though he talks about principles, I can't find principles in there.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
I find a lot of really fascinating data that may or may not be true. But finding principles, that's the key thing. And principles always are reduced down to simplicity. They're easy to understand. And that's a great part about them. Okay, number six. Unchecked emotions can make that which is not true seem to be true. So we have to get a hold of our emotional cells and realize that our emotional self is a little bit like a mirror. You know, you look in a mirror, you don't see your real image, you see your reverse image. Put up a page of print in a mirror, and it's, you won't be able to read it because it's all reversed. And this is what the emotional self does. It reverses everything. It looks like it's you. You look in a mirror, it looks like it's you, but it's not really you. It's you reversed. And so the emotional body does this to us. It takes everything that's reality and it reverses it. And so if you follow your emotional self, it will lead you into a lot of illusion. But the emotional self is important. You know what the emotional self does for us? It takes us into experience that we would have never went into on our own. So,
well, that's what women do. You know, women represent the emotional aspect as well. I've been led into experiences by being with certain women that I never would have gone into on my own.
Yeah, so. I'll tell you that once you get, and men do this too, both male and female are emotional. Women are more in touch with their emotional self. Now the higher part correspondence of the emotions is the intuition. And so the advanced female needs to get in contact with her intuitional self, which will neutralize that reversal in the emotional self. But yeah, the emotional energy, it leads us into quite the experience, but the experience is necessary. Without the experience of our physical reality and making all kinds of mistakes and getting in all kinds of difficult situations that we would have never got into in our right minds, we learn a lot. And so I think that the emotional self is all part of the divine plan to take us into an illusion that is like a school that teaches us what is true and what is not true, teaches us how to see reality divorced from illusion. So unchecked emotions, that's, we have to check our emotions. So when you, and falling in love is the easiest way to be deceived with your emotions. And this happens in both male and female. And what makes this happen is a point of truth, is that the Christ is in every living person on the planet. And if you meet somebody and they razzle dazzle you, what you do is you do not see any flaws in them. You look beyond their flaws. You see the Christ within them. When you see the Christ within them, you will fall in love with them. Okay? You will feel a strong attraction to them. And if they're on the opposite polarity of yourself, you will also have a romantic feeling about them. Now, when this happens, say you meet an axe murderer, okay? And he's an interesting person, and you don't see any faults, and because you look beyond his personality, you can fall in love with this person, okay? And it doesn't matter how bad he is or how many faults he has, you can fall in love with him. And what you need to ask yourself, you say, unchecked emotion, check your emotions. And I had this happen a number of times in my personal romantic life when I was single. I was several times attracted to the wrong person. And I felt a tremendous pull, yet my mind says, wrong person. This person is not for you. And so there's a struggle between the mind and the emotions. And the mind must prevail in this case. If it doesn't prevail, you'll wind up with the wrong person, and the only benefit will be the lessons that you learn from all of the pain and suffering that you're going to go through.
Good. That you would have gone through with Georgia.
Yeah, that was kind of a struggle for me. But I knew my mind was right on that one. Okay. Okay, any ran over time here. Any comments or questions before we wrap it up? We'll continue this next week. Okay, you've been a good group, and we will look forward to seeing you. Next week is the 4th of July on Sunday, so wouldn't be a great day to do our class. So we'll plan on having it Tuesday on the 6th at 8 p.m. I'll be in. Well, I'll be posting something on that. Everybody have a good 4th next week.
I'll be posting a questionnaire.
Not in America, have a good one anyway.
Yeah, join our thought forum.
It's all an illusion. All the world's a stage. We're acting out our role.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the truth.
Let's have a big bang on the 4th of July.
Yeah.
Have a 5th on the 4th.
Don't anybody start any fires with this hot spell we're having.
No.